Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
So the U.S. has won. They beat Iran 1-0. Christian Pulisic with the match's only goal. And there was a lot of faux falling at the end by Iran and the whole thing. I got it. Okay, get up and play. Hey, Friscats, come on. Stop trying to draw fouls. Get up and play. Iran, gone. So on to the knockout round. They get the Netherlands next. You want to know who the happiest people on the face of the earth are right now? Fox. They put all this money in. They needed the U.S. to get through. Yeah, they weren't there in 2018 at all. They're just sitting there like, the Murdochs were like finding religion. Oh, go, please, Lord, please. Get them through. All right. Time now for our play-by-play call of the day.
Pickett's going to go shotgun, wide side to his left. And Gunner's in the shotgun, inside Deontay. They hand it off, and running left and getting to the end zone is Benny Snell Jr., his first rushing touchdown of the year, and the Steelers leapfrog back on top. He gets a shotgun snap. He's back, going for two. He waits. He runs. He's looking right. He's throwing for the end zone, and it's caught for the two-point conversion. Pickett to Pickett.
Bill Ilgrove with the calls last night, and the Steelers won 24-17 over Indianapolis. My goodness, Matt Ryan looked old. Ooh, we'll talk to Neal Coolong in the final half hour today. But today's show is brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. Online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, best in new inventory, all, by the way, with great warranties. Fabulous pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors guarantee. And a service department that's outstanding. And they need more technicians than ever because they're getting more work than ever. It's all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. All right, Ben Jones, StateCollege.com, joins us. Hello, Ben. Great to have you with us.
Hey, Steve. Thanks for having me. I'm doing great.
Oh, by the way, Iran and the U.S., I know you're rooting for the U.S. Just one quick, you want one of the keys of the game? I strongly recommend the U.S. score. All right, let's move on from that. It seems to be one of the overall keys. And when you've only scored once in over 200 minutes, it doesn't inspire a lot of confidence. Let's get to this football team. Unranked in the preseason, what did we witness as the season progressed?
I think you saw a team that started out young, started out figuring out what it was all about, and then really leaned into that. I think that, you know, we knew that this Penn State team was going to have some growing pains, and I think for the most part they worked out of them well. I think they started the season, obviously, with the challenges that they had to face on the road, came out on top of that. And then I think after the Ohio State game in particular, you know, certainly the opponent helps a little bit, but I thought they've been playing some of their best football. And I've said right along that I think, you know, you look a couple years down the road from now, you're going to say, man, this team had Abdul Carter, it had Drew Aller, it had all these different guys that were on that roster, Nick Singleton, Catron Allen, and you go, man, I can't believe that they had them all together. They got so much older and so much better together, and I think you've started to see that over the last couple weeks because really this time of year there are no freshmen left on a roster.
What were your thoughts on Olu Fashanu's decision?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, at face value, it's surprising, but obviously, you know, people and families and situations, you always have those conversations behind the scenes of, you know, what do we want for ourselves? Do you want to finish to your degree? Do you want to get a little bit better? Are there testing things that you feel like maybe you could do better at? I think it's always a difficult decision to make, especially if you're a guy like him who goes, look, I'm probably a top 15 pick. And realistically, that draft stock is not really probably going to get better just because there's, you know, lots and lots of good players out there every single year. So, you know, for him, I think, you know, he talked about things that he wanted to finish. You know, certainly his degree is one of those. And I do think that he's going to get bigger and stronger and better. And, you know, does he go higher next year? Does he go lower next year? You know, I think at the end of the day, he's going to be a good football player for a long time. That's going to make a bigger difference to him. But, you know, at face value, I was certainly surprised. And I think, you know, it's a good sign for Penn State moving forward, especially on the blind side of whoever, wink, wink, their next quarterback might be.
Nine Penn State defensive players were recognized in one form or another, first, second, third team honorable mention by the Big Ten. What were your thoughts on the defensive ballot?
Yeah, I mean, I think you always want to see Jair Brown as a guy, to me, who is maybe not the flashiest or the most physical compared to some guys that have been in his spot before, but I think he has been consistently at the right place at the right time. But yeah, I mean, a big part of Penn State's success this year has been on the defensive side of the ball. I think Manny Diaz has done a great job at all three levels. I think they've had great playmakers at all three levels. So, you know, I think, you know, you could argue that more guys deserve to be on that first team, but the Big Ten has got a lot of great defensive players. You know, I think even to a certain extent, you could argue that Kalen King has had a slightly better year than Joey Porter Jr., but, you know, it all works out in the end. And I think the fact that they had nearly the entire defense recognized in one way or another is pretty representative of how well they played this year.
What do you think about the bowl situation, still with some key games to be played this weekend?
Yeah, I mean, I think if you told a Penn State fan that Penn State was going to be 10-2 at the end of the year and have a chance of being in a New Year's Six bowl, you know, I think that everyone would take that without hesitation. You know, I do think that for Penn State, you know, if they end up in the Cotton Bowl, obviously that is great. You know, if you end up playing Tulane, that's obviously a team that, you know, maybe doesn't have the brand recognition that other programs do, even if they've had a good year and have a great mascot. I think that that's maybe the only disappointment in all of this. And obviously, you know, we saw last time Penn State played in the Cotton Bowl and Memphis came and showed up and played a great game. It's not in no means mean to disrespect Tulane's season, but I think Penn State has been a while since they've been able to play, really since the Rose Bowl, you know, back a couple of years ago, in a bowl game that has sort of an exciting marquee opponent to go along with it. But, you know, again, Dallas is fun. The Cotton Bowl is fun. And at the end of the day, if Penn State's got a chance to win 11 games in a year, I suppose that's more important than where the bowl is.
How do you view the Rose Bowl situation if Michigan wins? Do you think there's a shot, or is it unrealistic?
I mean, it's a good question, just relative to the idea that Ohio State was just there. I mean, I think, you know, when it comes to bowl games, they're saying who's going to travel, who is going to get us eyeballs, who is going to make for an interesting matchup. And I think, you know, it's hard to argue against Ohio State's pull, and certainly Penn State is right up there with the Buckeyes in terms of, you know, national recognition, the ability to pull in TV numbers. You know, I think for my money, and this is no disrespect to Penn State, I think Ohio State's a slightly more fun team to watch at times, which bodes well for that setting in the Rose Bowl and in Washington. If that's how that works out, would be fun for an opponent. But certainly, you know, we've heard time and time again over the years that bowls in general try and avoid, you know, a situation where you see the same team twice in a row. But, you know, the Rose Bowl is special, and certainly Ohio State, even if last weekend didn't go their way, is as good as anybody in the country.
C.J. Stroud, though, was a little, you know, was – and justifiably wishy-washy on it. And he's not going to definitively say what he's going to do, but he was very wishy-washy to the point where everybody got the feeling that if they're not in the playoff, he's not playing in the game. Does that play a factor?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a fair question and a fair evaluation of who do you want to put in the bowl, because I do think, you know, there's no question that if Penn State is in the Rose Bowl, that everybody's playing in that game. And you know, Sean Clifford said, you know, he's playing, and obviously I don't know necessarily why anyone thought that Sean Clifford wouldn't be playing in the bowl game, but nevertheless, he made that point. I'm sure all of the younger guys would be playing as well. So, you know, there is that aspect of it, and it sort of goes with, you know, how do you evaluate Tennessee too, which is unrelated to the Rose Bowl, but that sort of question of, do you put a team in a bowl because of what they did all year? Do they put them in because of who's going to play in that game? I think it's a little bit of both, and certainly if C.J. Stroud says, look, I'm not going to play, you know, certainly Ohio State's got a good enough quarterback room that it's not like he'd be putting me out there. But that certainly plays into the equation as well.
Well, what's interesting about it is that they can, you know, they can only guess based off of his post-game answer, because he's not going to say before the decision is made. Right, and that's, you know, it was only his post-game answer, and everybody in the room that was there and wrote said, hey, look, it just sounds like and seems like that's it, unless they're in the playoff game. And they could be in the playoff game. So when you look at the scenarios of the weekend, if TCU were to lose, and Kansas State's a good team, so let's play guesstimate here, Ben. What's your guesstimate as to what it could look like if everything else holds form?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's an argument to be made to say, look, Ohio State and Michigan have been two of the four best teams in the country all year. And I think, you know, we don't have enough time to unpack the SEC and Big Ten comparisons fully, but I do think that, you know, the precedent is there that you can have two teams from the same conference in the playoff, and they don't have to be undefeated. They don't have to be perfect. And I think Ohio State and Michigan are, as a pairing, as good as any two teams, give or take, that the SEC has put into the playoffs over the same year. And I think the fact that the SEC is basically Georgia and then a bunch of other teams that are very good but not quite that good, you know, I think that you have to consider that. So, you know, to me, I'd like to see the Big Ten get two teams into the playoffs just for the sake of balancing that thing out right before, you know, it expands and it doesn't matter anymore. But yeah, I mean, the argument's there to be made for Ohio State. Up until last weekend, everybody knew and everybody thought that they were one of the best teams in America, and certainly Michigan ran them over, and that'll happen sometimes, but I don't think it changes the fact that Ohio State and Michigan as two teams are as good as anything, if not better than the SEC has to offer this year.
Imagine if that happened and the fourth team is USC. And USC's coming into the Big Ten. And if you had a 12-team playoff this year, Penn State'd be hosting a game. How about that?
I mean,
it doesn't matter now, but, you know, it's just kind of interesting to think, that's all.
Yeah, I think I tweeted the other night that we're so used to seeing USC, you know, playing in marquee games on TV because they're in a big moment, that it's going to be weird in a couple years when it's 1 a.m. and we're watching Northwestern lose by 30 on the other side of the country on FS1 or the Big Ten Network or whatever it is. It's definitely a brave new world, but I know that I'm glad that I'm not in charge of the logistics getting them across the country.
I'm glad I'm not either, Ben. Always a pleasure. Appreciate it very much.
Yep, thanks for having me, Steve.
All right. Neal Coolong in the final half hour. The U.S. has won. They have vanquished Iran. Get out of here. Go home. Done.
Bingo!
U.S. now gets Netherlands next. Now, that won't be easy, but it's the knockout round. All right, Christian Vayer transfer portal. Not unexpected, obviously. I don't think anybody sat there and went, oh, really? I'm taken aback. No. And Olu Fashanu, I think, surprised a lot of people yesterday by electing to return for the 2023 season. And as I said earlier, and this is something, again, this is not a post-mortem comment. I mean, Matt, what did I say about him during the year? That neither decision would surprise me, right?
Correct.
And that's it, you know, I mean, if you're in the top 10, is it surprising he'd go? No. If you know him to a certain degree, and if you've talked to him, which obviously the fans have not had an opportunity to do, and not a lot of people have had an opportunity to do. But I've, you know, that's unfortunate in my job. I can do that. He is a highly intelligent articulate, well thought of young man. Comes from a family that really values education, really does. So remember when he had the meeting, I think it was, let's say it was during, it was after the Minnesota game, right? And he said, well, I'm going to meet with the parents and see how, you know, and talk with them and give them a read on, you know, the process and what happens and you know, just at least give them some background as to help them make whatever decision they're going to make. And well, he's gone. And I said, I said, I wouldn't say that yet, only because they value education so much. And he's also 19. Now, that works two ways. One, he's young, 19. He won't turn 20 until the spring. But that also would mean that your second you'd be available for your second contract when you're 24. You need 23 at minimum, but 24 in all likelihood, because they would pick up your option year. And that, you know, it's like, wow. And Jack and I have talked about that many times. The way it works now, well, getting to that second contract in the NFL means everything. You get really good money as a rookie, but your opportunity to make great money is the second contract. And for some players, the earlier they can get to it in life, the better. So it does come into play, but again, he is scheduled to graduate a year from now in supply chain and information. And when you talk to him, he's one of those guys that likes to talk about academics and about the academic side, and he talks more about that than he does football. This is a guy this year that gave up exactly, oh, that's right, zero sacks. None. In fact, I don't even know if he gave up a hurry this year. And you notice in the Ohio State game, JTT, who had a great game for Ohio State, that goes without saying. When he was matched up on Fashanu, what did he do? Nothing. It wasn't until they flipped him to the other side that that's where he became a game changer. And credit was, I mean, Ola was just, he's really good. Great feet, long arms, athletic, really smart. So, that is, now, obviously, a huge plus getting him back. Drew Shelton has now had invaluable experience. You're going to get Landon Tangwall back. Hunter Nozad's coming back. You know, wait to see what Sal Wormley wants to do. I mean, and obviously, you got to wait and see what Juice wants to do. You got a couple of recruits coming in. And, of course, I still can't mention their names till they sign 3 weeks from tomorrow, but okay. And there's all these rules that, like, have opened everything up, but you still can't do something like that. Yeah, I still can't do something like that. And then you look at J.B. Nelson. Now, he can now play in the bowl game, and it won't affect his status. He'll still have 2 years left. Venga Ioane can play in the bowl game. It will not affect his status. I mean, he's going to have 4 years left. And Ioane is going to be a really good player. And I think J.B. Nelson is actually, to his credit, becoming a good player. I liked what I saw from J.B. Nelson when he was out there. Ioane is going to be really good, I think. So there, you know, you want to do the best you can to be set in those trenches to then set up everything else. But for the quarterbacks, and in this case Drew Aller and then Bo Prabula, I mean, what a security blanket knowing that 74 is over there is going to be at your back. Wow. Not bad moving forward. Neal Coolong, final half hour. Matt, any controversy you want to get into? Because that's the only area you seem to thrive.
I'm a little disappointed in Jair Brown getting third team all Big Ten selection, but
Jair Brown should be a first team selection.
Yeah, I think that is just a travesty.
But again, here's the issue. You know what a lot of people do when they vote on these teams? They look at stats.
Right. Which he didn't have, okay. But yeah.
No, I mean, well, this is what he doesn't have. He's got 59 tackles. If he's got 100, oh, well.
Yep.
To go with 3 interceptions. And that's how this happens. People don't watch enough. And because I think he's the best safety in the Big Ten. That's me.
I agree.
But I'm also extremely prejudiced. You know that.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, the best in new inventory. No getting around it. All with great warranties. Great pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors guarantee, which is so important in your buying experience. And a great service department, fabulous technicians that back all of this up for the life of your vehicle. In fact, because of them, it extends the life of your vehicle. It is all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Let me give you a quick stat here, Matt. Notre Dame this year, they're forced to play under their agreement ACC teams. And in this particular year, they played 4 of them. So what was Notre Dame's record against the ACC this year?
I think it was 4-0.
Yes. Not only was it 4-0, they beat all 4 teams by double digits apiece.
Yeah, that's right.
Thanks. I appreciate the affirmation.
I just like
so much
putting
better.
That together, including North Carolina, who's in the, of course, in the conference championship
and
game.
And Clemson. And Clemson, which is in the championship game. They beat all 4 by double digits. Wow. Now, they did the college football playoff predictor. Guess who's at 71% to make the playoff?
Notre Dame?
No.
I was going to say, what?
They got 4 losses,
yeah.
For the sakes. I mean, Penn State's got 2.
And Clemson?
No. Ohio State.
Ah.
They are higher on the predictor than USC.
I can't say I'm surprised by that.
I'm just telling you what the predictor says.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So I think tonight it'll be 1 Georgia, 2 Michigan, 3 TCU, 4 I think will be USC, 5 will be Ohio State, 6 will be Alabama, 7 will be Tennessee, Penn State will be 8.
That's how I see it.
So, again, TCU has a problem. All right. Now, they have one area where they're undefeated. So they win. They are absolutely in and should be in. It's hard to win. I don't know. Well, they schedule it. Please. It's hard to win. All right? Hard. But Kansas State is actually pretty good. Not a bad defensive team. Deuce Vaughn is an outstanding running back. I mean, I really got a chance to watch him last year in the bowl game. And, you know, I love watching bowl games. Well, that's where I really got. And you know what? And get this. They could lose the game. And Will Howard has played terrific at quarterback. replacing Adrian Martinez. That's one of the reasons why I think Chris Fowler and Kirk Herbstreit, why they're doing this game. It's the best game. And I know Heather Dinich thinks when it's all said and done, Ohio State will be in the playoff. If Ohio State's in the playoff, Penn State's going to Pasadena. Simple as that. So, watch that game. That could be the game that opens the door. We'll see. All right. Steelers. All right. Looking at, in the season of miracles, and as a senior season of miracles, you know that. All right?
Oh, my almighty!
I mean, come on. You know. You watch the... Have you ever watched the movie Die Hard?
I've heard of it, but I've never seen it.
Oh, come on!
I know. As I've told you before, I know. I'm very bad with movies. I know.
Yeah. Connor Bazelick, by the way, have been the starting quarterback in Indiana. Doom. Transfer portal. Gone. All right. But Clarence Gilliard, who passed away today, plays Theo in the movie Die Hard. And at one point, Alan Rickman, his character says, he said, we're going to need a miracle to open this last lock. And he says, Theo, it's the season for miracles. And to show you that, the Steelers won last night. There you go. All right. So with that, we bring in Neal Coolong. Sir, welcome. Always a pleasure.
It's great to be here as always. I hope you guys are not wrapped in a snowband right now the way that I am. I've shoveled the driveway and the walkway twice already, and at least one more coming by the end of the night here.
I am sitting in Clemson, South Carolina. It is 65 degrees. I have basketball tonight.
This was not the comment to make to me right now. Not even close.
I understand, but that's why I said it. All right.
Well, thank you. So, I can see you're here for me, Steve.
Yeah, that's right, Neal. I'm there for you all the time, pal. This is the season of miracles. they won last night. Let's start with Kenny Pickett. Second straight game, he had a really good first half. Then after a shaky start to the second half, they responded with that drive. What did he show you on that drive?
I more than anything, I think it showed, I don't want to say short-term memory, because that's a boring cliche and it's not even close to true, and you don't want a quarterback with the inexperience issue that Kenny Pickett has forgetting things, but they rebounded from what they usually fall into to start second half, and they have. I mean, against Cincinnati, they went, what, five straight three and outs to start the half? Went from a competitive game to slipping out of their control by the fourth quarter. Last night, it was kind of like, all right, you know what? We were doing well. Let's get back into this, okay? You could feel the energy on that drive. You could see that it was like, this is something that was discussed on the sidelines, and I know that the whole rallying speech thing is not really, all that tangible in the NFL. It doesn't really work like that. But
no,
the energy was there. You could tell that their focus increased quite a bit. And that's not to say that you can't have, two straight kind of clunker drives. It happens. It's not that it's a problem. But it looked to me like Pickett took it upon himself to say, we're not letting this happen again. We're not going to blow our next 20 plays and let this team completely back into the game. We need to do something about this right now. And they did. They responded well. That's just simply not something we've seen from this team often, if at all, so far this season. So very encouraging. I mean, you can't be completely results based in evaluating a team like this. You have to kind of see their progression in comparison to similar spots earlier in the year. And I think with that, there were a lot of positives to take away from it. And the win is obviously nice. Just trying to be opponent agnostic here, it doesn't really matter. The situation was what it was. They're playing an NFL team. Nameless gray faces and all that. they went out and executed to a pretty good level. And they were fairly consistent with that throughout the game. Could have been better. You're going to say that about every game. The bar isn't set incredibly high for this team, but we've seen them improve quite a bit offensively from where they were over the first like quarter of the season. I kind of figured that's what this team was going to look like this year, and it's good to see at this point now it's starting to take root. You know, it's probably too late for this year, but they can build on it moving forward.
Lost in the shuffle as the season has gone, we have rarely talked about Benny Snell. What did you see from him last night?
I forgot how he ran. I even wrote this down just right away because it was like, I haven't seen Benny Snell run a ball in the regular season in a while. I mean, he did pretty well. You can't fault where he is on the roster. It's next man up. He had to step up and play, and he did a great job. His numbers were good. He looked good doing it. He made plays on the ground. He made plays in the air. You got a lot of quality play from the running back. From Pittsburgh on Monday night. You have to be happy about that. It goes to show again, the offensive line is starting to really form into something that I don't think anybody would have really anticipated. I said at the beginning of the year, they're going to struggle a bit offensively right away. The offensive line in particular, they're going to be rough right away. They need time. They need snaps. And that's going to come with negative consequences at the beginning of the season. But if they're good, if what they're doing is working, you're going to see them improve measurably toward the end of the season. And I feel like we're starting to see that. And it's fun. It's good to see, you know, perhaps not all of them. I don't think Dan Moore played particularly well again. But it's good to see them, you know, get a little get back to all the people that wrote them off a long time ago. I thought you have to take your cap off to them simply because they showed up and they played well. Indianapolis is a very similar team to Pittsburgh in a lot of ways. They should be a better defensive unit, I think, than what they have been top to bottom. There's talent on that defense. They can play. The offensive line had a pretty good challenge in front of them. I thought they held themselves very well, particularly early. I thought they did a good job controlling the game, and they've had some pretty good running performances the last couple weeks. And, you know, you haven't seen the quarterback turn the ball over. That's a good thing that you can associate with protection as well. Alex Highsmith knows that. He leads the NFL in strip sacks now. You need to be able to protect your quarterback if you want to protect the ball. So I feel like they're doing a very good job overall, certainly in comparison to where they started this year.
Is there any particular reason why Deontay Johnson thinks he's a number one receiver?
The agent in me would say because they throw him the ball as often as the number one receiver. It's kind of hard to argue that. Maybe not this season so much, but you look over Johnson's career, he's got every reason to think that he is a player who's receiving, you know, the yeoman's share of targets in his team's passing offense.
Yeah.
I would be... You know, I would struggle to defend how that would justify the fact that he can't get north and south and you know, try to get the ball upfield. He tries to do a bit too much, I think. It's just in peewee football, you might be able to run the swinging gate thing.
Yeah.
You know, you might be able to outflank your opponent. It's not going to happen. And if he hasn't learned that by now, I don't know what to tell him. But he cost him 4 yards. I mean, it's one thing that you take the extra sidestep outside because maybe you can get around and get a few more yards. It doesn't work out. You might lose a yard. He lost 4. I mean, it was like, dude, what are you doing? Not an ideal situation. And it's dropping touchdown passes doesn't help either. Not an ideal situation overall from Deontay Johnson. But he's a talented player. I don't get into number one, number two, number three receiver, all of that. That's more of a fantasy football and a draft connotation than actual reality. But they get him the ball often. He usually makes things happen. He can get himself open. I think if anything, he might be frustrated because his targets are down a bit and they're not making plays after the catch the way that they used to. Teams are tackling them where they stand often. Just that's probably a byproduct of an offense that's not really trying to get the ball downfield consistently all that much. So I think he's probably trying to do a little bit too much. But sometimes, if anything, and I hate to say this because I usually lean on comments like this, but look at Antonio Brown. Nobody expected Antonio Brown to run through anybody. Certainly not Spencer Lansing, and he's not going to be able to run through anybody unless he jumps, doesn't clear the guy's helmet, and kicks him in the face. He's not running through anybody. He would get the ball, and if he had an opportunity, he would, make a move, get in the open field, his best open field runner of his era. If he didn't have it, though, he went down, and nobody got after him about it. It's not a question of toughness. Deontay Johnson is maybe a shade bigger than Antonio Brown. Nobody's asking him to square up to a safety 15 yards down the field. But you're not going to be able to outrun everybody either. They've got the angle on you. There comes a point you got to protect the ball and just get forward. If you like dive down head first, that's fine. They can't hit you anyway. It's okay to do that. You caught the ball, you secured it. The opportunity wasn't there to run. Don't try to make more out of that because, frankly, you're not athlete enough to take NFL players around the edge like that. You're not going to be able to do it.
Yeah, because I think that Pickens, I really like. Freiermuth and Gentry, really like. I remember when Johnson was doing his hold in, I said, I wouldn't even return his calls. That's just me. Did Watt make the trip? Just asking for a friend.
I saw, and what was interesting to me, I saw Watt walking off the field after the game. He looked like he was hobbling a little bit. That's not to suggest there was an injury, but we don't see many pretty high-end Steelers defensive performances that T.J. Watt was not an instrumental part of. And he really wasn't. Not to, he doesn't have to be on every game. He just is. He's T.J. Right. Watt, defensive player of the year for a reason. That was kind of a null game for him. Suggest he didn't do anything at all, but
because he's getting doubled. Quiet. I mean, I know that. I mean, he's getting a lot of attention. You just make the comment. You're watching Nick Bosa, like, okay, he's getting a lot of attention too. He's making plays.
Exactly. And the fact that Watt didn't and Highsmith had a real nice game with Watt on the field, I don't know how many times that's really happened. I mean, Highsmith was excellent. Right. I thought he did a great job. The idea of having both of them together is to create that conflict, that pressure. If you only got one back in the backfield to block, who are you going to have to chip? It's going to have to be play side. It opens up for the other guy to step in and make a play. Highsmith lived up to his side of that. And Highsmith had done well in Watt's absence. I'm not at all suggesting Highsmith hasn't played well this year. He has. But to see Watt kind of get neutralized by a team and Highsmith step up and make a couple of the biggest plays of the game. He forced a fumble. He made the big stop on third and short at the end that really kicked timeout gate into gear today. You have to be very happy with that. And you hope Watt is okay, but Highsmith playing the way that he is, it's almost more like you kind of want to see what he's going to do next now. How is he going to continue to improve? And what are the Steelers going to do with them? How can they really open up the two of them moving down the stretch? I think that's probably the most enjoyable thing for me to look forward to now.
Yeah, Highsmith was terrific last night. He really was. When you look at the Colts, and you talk about the timeout part at the end, I know what the goal was. I understand they were trying to leave as little time as possible at the end if they could and score a touchdown and get the thing to overtime or maybe even a two-point conversion. That part I've got. But they overmanaged it, don't you think? I mean, there's 40 seconds left. They still got three timeouts, and you've got a quarterback at 37. Like, know where the stick is. Keep running.
It's kind of funny because it was almost like three or four wrongs made a right to get them into the situation that they were in. Overall, I don't think the situation was managed very well. Specifically, here's what you have. This is what I saw. After Matt Ryan galloped his way, kicking the sun back into the sky and chugging out 14 yards, but not making it to the six, what I saw was a Steelers secondary that was in a prevent defense. They had seven defensive backs on the field. The Colts were in 11 personnel. You can run and pass out of that in today's offense, not to mention the fact you got Jonathan Taylor in the backfield. Okay.
Right.
I like that situation to run the ball. If I call timeout, what do you think the Steelers are going to counter with? Not prevent defense.
Right, exactly.
You put three light safeties on the field. Your running options kind of go away. And when you have in that hypothetical case, you'd still have two timeouts. You want the option to run the ball. To me, I don't think it was a bad idea. But
the
problem really isn't that he didn't call timeout. It's the fact that it took him 24 seconds to line up. It's like, you don't need to call the timeout there. I know how funny it was and how everyone jumped on it. Not nearly as stupid as people think it is. Not nearly as stupid. You're perfectly fine with the defense the Steelers have out on the field. The Pittsburgh Steelers defense, you'd rather them seven defensive backs than seven up front in that situation. So you've got the schematic advantage. You just didn't need to take that much time and let them get set and recognize, well, you're probably going to run the ball. Because guess what happened? Alex Highsmith even said it after the game. As soon as they lined up, I knew exactly what they were going to do. And the tight end never had a chance on Highsmith. Highsmith was on Taylor when the ball was snapped. He knew exactly what was happening. And the play got blown up. I'm not 100% sure it wouldn't have gotten stopped anyway. It looked like the two safeties, ironically, were crashing the gap anyway. So I'm not sure it would have mattered. But the point is, the timeout was irrelevant. I really don't think it matters. The reason I say that is if you let's hypothetically say they get third and three, they get to like the 23-yard line. Call timeout there. There's about 30 seconds left on the clock from the 23. They've still got two timeouts. Is that a bad situation to be in? Pretty nice, in my opinion. You've got plenty of time to throw to the sticks. You can still run if you have that schematic advantage again because you have two timeouts. And you can work it down to the 10. When you're at the 10 and you've got two, three plays, my opinion, anytime that you leave a play on the field, it's probably more negative than it is positive. But if that chain of events would have included you converting on third and four, which keep in mind, they never did. That's the problem here. There's no difference at all how many timeouts Jeff Saturday finished the game with because they failed to convert. All right? Plays are more important than timeouts are. You have to remember that. You're on the field to score points.
Yep.
Whatever play you can have to score points is the plays you need to call. So I think people make way too big a deal out of timeouts and what they think is clock management. There is a factor to that for sure, but it's inexact. It's not as easy as people think it is. I don't think it was that big of a deal. I think in the end they failed to make plays offensively the entire game, and I'm not totally surprised that they fizzled out at the end.
Oh, believe me, timeouts are a big TV thing. I mean, all the time. We talk about that all the time in basketball, for example.
Yeah.
Like the rebound, 8 seconds left. Call a timeout. No, if you've got an experienced team, guess what? Put them on their heels. Make them guess.
Yep. Exactly.
And that's. I'll tell you, Matt Ryan looked old last night. He did.
He did. I jokingly said this, and I feel kind of bad about it, but like, the end is coming soon for Matt Ryan. You just can't tell if it's at the end of the season, after week 15, or at halftime. I mean, it looked like he played on Wednesday night. I mean, he was not ready at all in that game. And I even just did it now. I apologize. That was not a Thursday night football game, but did not feel like a Thursday night football game. It was so slow moving, and Ryan might have been more the problem than anything else. But he's not going to play beyond this season. I don't. A great career. I'm not trying to bash the guy or anything, but there's not much he can do. You know, he's got that same Phil Rivers, Ben Roethlisberger real issue the first three, four drives of the game. It takes him that long to get warmed up. Ryan, in all fairness, should have turned the ball over the first four times he touched it. I mean, it was bad. Not a good game from him at all. Big reason why they lost, and they're not going to win playing with that level of quarterback.
If it makes you feel better, I'll be back in the cold tonight.
Well, good. I'll tell you this: avoid the North. You don't want this.
I do Big Ten football and basketball.
Oh, okay. Wow.
I see everything. Okay. Neal, always a pleasure. Appreciate you, my friend.
Definitely. Enjoy the warmth. Thanks for having me, guys. Yeah.
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.